How does it feel as you see this great crowd and this little 500 victory, Kyle Hamilton?
It's awesome. I really can't believe it.
Race fans, your winner of the 69 Palace Little 500, Kyle Hamilton from Indianapolis. Tony Stewart, Smoke, you had really an excellent pacing through this. You showed the necessary patience. You were always moving ahead. Your reflections on what for you, rare, but a first-time experience.
It was everything they said it was going to be and more. You drive for Rob and Richard Hoffman, and you have an excellent driver coach like Eric Gordon that's won this thing 9 times. That's a big advantage to somebody that's never been here. So, having those 3 guys in your corner, I mean, that's the tools that you need to do your job. It's just a matter of me going out and doing mine. But, I got myself in a couple bad spots there and got into a couple lap cars and bent the steering on it. And it slowed us down for a while, and then I could kind of figure out what I could do with it. And we were able to fight Kody to get back, to one, to either lead lap or 1 lap down there. And I figured if we got a caution, that would be really big for us. So that lap ended up being huge. It got us to the podium.
How much did you have a sense going into this, Tony, that pit strategy was important with that mandatory first one inside of 250? You went in about 185 or something like that, as I recall. That was a good move early on through the first half of the race, wasn't it?
Yeah, that's Rob Hoffman's experience. I mean, they're not the winningest sprint car team in USAC history for no reason. I mean, they're there because they're smart and they know how to play the strategy here. And, he did a great job of keeping us in good position all night. And like I said, I was the weak spoke in the wheel there and got myself in trouble a couple of times with a couple lap cars that, really got us behind there. So I was worried about whether I was going to be able to make 500 laps around here. But, the last, like you said, with 150 to go there, and we had Kody in our sight to get that lap back, that was all the motivation we needed. Yeah, but I'm just glad I got a Busch beer. I haven't had a beer for 3 months, and my girlfriend's tried to get me in shape for this damn race, and now I can drink all the damn beer I want, so you can bet your ass I'm going to do it tonight.
Okay, so here we are with Rob at the race shop in Ohio. And Rob, could you tell us, what are we looking at here? What's in your race shop? What's the highlight?
I've got 3 cars in here right now. I've got my dirt sprint car sitting here. I've got a pavement sprint car that I built last year to run the little 500. And then I've got the B sprint car that we just ran the little 500 with.
This is the car that we just saw in the little 500 a few days ago.
Right.
Rob, can you tell me about your Little 500 race this year, which was just a few nights ago on Saturday night?
We had high hopes going into it, but on the first lap, they had the aborted start. We were kind of a ping pong and ended up getting a puncture in our left rear sidewall. Didn't know it until late in the caution that occurred, and we ducked into the pits, but because he wasn't up at the lead car when he ducked into the pits, the lead car was almost all the way around the track, and then we ended up coming in and we lost 2 laps, and it just spiraled downhill from there.
Was that bump right at the start, right?
At the
green
flag. Yep, coming to the green.
I got video of that.
Yeah, I'm not really happy about that, but Brady, he's such a good driver. He's great at avoiding things, and that was just like, I didn't know where he was going to go. There was just no place for him to go to kind of be safe. So
I saw that.
That kind of put us behind. And, when you are at the back of the pack, you end up getting lapped right away. So we went down a third lap, and then it was just no matter what we did, it seemed like we just lost a lap. So now this shop that you're standing in, we built this building in 1973 here because we went IndyCar racing. And this was built to house and maintain the IndyCar. But if you look over here.
This was the IndyCar race shop at one time.
Yes.
But not since the 70s.
In 1973, we built it, and we had Indy cars through 1985.
70s and 80s. Ah, okay.
If you look right there where it has the concrete filled in, that was actually for grain scales, and it was set up for a sprint car. So we still were going to maintain the sprint car operation through all this. And these were pockets that we had in the concrete, and the full big grain scale set in there, and that's how we weighed the car back in the day.
Ah, okay.
Before we had those nice electronic scales and everything. On the wall, we've got pictures of a lot of cars through the years. You know, my formative years, I was growing up with sprint cars, and then we got the IndyCar, and I really cut my teeth on IndyCars. I mean,
and there's some right there.
Yeah, oh, yeah. Right in front of us. Here I am. That's at Milwaukee with little Joe Saldana. There I am at Michigan. I think we had Jerry Sneed in the car that time. Coincidentally, here's Kevin Doran, who is Kody Swanson's guru.
Ah.
Yeah, he's a local guy here. And he helped us out back in the day.
And some very 80s looking cars with those really super, super wide side pods.
Yep, we had that for sure. Next door here, we've got our machine shop. This was actually the original shop that we had Hoffman Auto Racing in when my grandfather bought this farm out here in 1948. And this shop, this shop housed at various times one to three race cars. And invariably the car that you wanted to race was all the way at the back of the shop. And you had to like make these cars movable so that you could move the car that you wanted to race out. It started out life here on the farm as a chicken coop. And my dad fondly told me stories about how he had to come out here and scrape the chicken crap off the floor and get it all cleaned up so that they could turn it into a race shop. But we've got a lot of equipment in here of varying vintages. Not a whole lot of new stuff. I learned on a lathe a lot older than this. It was a belt driven, like 1908 LeBlanc lathe, and this was like a huge upgrade when we got it. So it was a lot better for my machine skills to start using something like this. We have a shear here that we use extensively when we're doing the sheet metal work on the car. And
shearing sheet metal, okay.
Shearing sheet metal, and this was built in 1908.
Whew.
Yeah.
Wow.
I know, I mean, it's still got the great big belt drive over there. It got converted at some point and put an electric motor on it. Obviously, we didn't buy this new, but a lot of this stuff came from auctions. My grandfather loved auctions. So, you know, we got maybe three pieces of equipment that we bought brand new in here, and everything else we bought secondhand. It's old, but it does the job.
Oh, yeah, there's, I see the belt drive, yeah.
Yep. Belt drive drill press.
Wow.
That's been around since I've been here. So at least 60 years on that one. And then my dad got a milling machine, again, bought secondhand. And that has been key to my ability to build sprint cars. I notch all the tubing on this.
Oh, meaning to this day?
To this day.
To this day.
To this day. Absolutely. And of course, we've got a bunch of parts through the years. But we end up, when you have different chassis and we've been racing sprint cars for 30 some odd years, you end up with a collection of torsion arms like you wouldn't believe.
Mm-hmm.
We also have bearing carriers and front arms and everything else that you can think of, we've got here. Again, just collecting through the years. Down underneath the bench there, that's a Buick V6 engine. That's one of the two engines that we had for Vogler's 28V6 Sprinter that we won the championship with in 1989.
Huh.
And one of the few cars that we still have left here. Of course, my materials rack, tubing, sheet metal. It gets a lot more full when I start building a car.
My dad would find this all fascinating because he worked in manufacturing in a copper wire and cable factory.
I do my own. When I talk about building a car, I bend the tubes, I notch the tubes, I weld the tubes, you know. I do it all here. And I have a lot of great people come up here and help me out with this. My right-hand man, Dan Launderville, he came and he was our only full-time employee here at Hoffman Auto Racing for a lot of years. He came to join us in 1999 from Iowa. He said he was only going to probably stay about a year. He always wanted to see what it was like to be a sprint car mechanic. And he ended up retiring from racing in 2016 with me. So when I told him I was going to do a little 500 car, he loves the little 500. He thinks it's one of the greatest races ever, and he was all in. He's been up here for the last 3 years just busting his butt, helping me out. So I can't say enough good things about him. And I got my brother helping me a lot, too. He he was never really involved with the race team as much as I was. You know, when I said that I needed his help, he jumped right in. And he's responsible for doing most of the body panels on the car for me. I'm fabricating them up, and you know, I'll tell him what I want, and he'll produce it, and then I go take it over to the paint shop and paint it.
So, to be clear, this is not the Hoffman Racing Team race shop where they build and maintain the dirt USAC racing cars that Brady Bacon drives. That is not this shop.
Not anymore.
That's a different shop, which is, where is that shop?
That is in Union City, Ohio. That's Brady's shop.
So basically, this is your shop on which you, okay, the little 500 pavement car.
But that's all that we do here now is little.
That was the next question. And what else? But
Occasionally we'll do a dirt race. But since Brady has got so many people offering him dirt cars, we don't get him nearly as much anymore. And, you know, I don't like to go to a racetrack if I don't really feel like I have a good shot of winning. So if I've got Brady in the seat, I feel like I got a good shot at winning.
So Brady would sometimes drive a dirt car of yours, USAC National Series?
Through all of, until 2016. Mm-hmm. Hoffman Auto Racing, the dirt operation, operated right out of the shop.
Oh, okay. And then?
And then.
Dirt operation.
I retired from racing in 2016. Took a job as a bank president, and I said, I can't do both.
Oh, your present 9-to-5 job during the day, which is the reason why we didn't meet today between 9-to-5, because you're at the bank.
Yes.
Between 9-to-5 weekdays. Okay.
Exactly.
Which is why we're here at 6:30 in the evening
on
a weekday, because you were doing something else during the day.
Yeah, I was trying to catch up from being out of the office for a week with the little 500.
Okay.
So, yeah, it was pretty bad. But when I retired in 2016 and Dan retired in 2016, my dad still wanted to continue racing.
Mm-hmm.
So he basically funded an already operational race team to continue on as Hoffman Auto Racing. I think the first year he did it with Chad Baseflug or Kevin Thomas Jr. The second year, one of those two. And the third year, which was 2019, he did it with Brady Bacon. And then my dad died in April of 2019. Kind of unexpectedly, he was diagnosed with leukemia on the 14th of April, and he passed away on the 30th of April. So it was very sudden.
So quickly.
It was very sudden. So anyway, Brady and I continued on that year, and at the banquet that year, he said, "You want to do it next year?" And I said, I don't have the financial resources my dad had. And he said, let's just see what happens. So we did it in 20, and he won the championship in 20 and 21. With this type of arrangement, and then 22, he finished second in the championship.
So really dominant for the past few years.
He has been very dominant.
Really, really great for the team and Brady.
He's put together a heck of a team. Brady is a very, very smart guy as well, And I mean, it shows through and on the track with his driving, but also in how he applies the monies and the resources that he does have, because what he does have, he puts in the right place and optimizes it. And a lot of people can't do that.
Yeah.
We never optimized it on haulers. I mean, we're driving a 1989 Chaparral truck and trailer, so with almost 500,000 miles on it.
That one right there. Oh,
that
okay.
one right there.
That one right there. Okay, which still says Mean Green on it, even though they're not the primary sponsor.
No. Well, you know, I could peel it off, but I'd hate to see what's underneath it at this point, so I might as well just leave it there.
Oh, and that was the one that was used for taking the car to Anderson.
Oh, yeah.
That one right outside here. Okay.
Absolutely. We call her Big Red.
I like old school.
Yeah. That's not bad. Well, I don't know whether you want to cut away or not, but we've got other shops to see. So, over here, we call this the tire shop because we mount and balance our tires in here, also our fuel depot. But over the years, it has become a collection for other people's stuff. My uncle's Bug Eye Sprite, a different uncle, has his Corvette in here. That was his dad's. Here's a Hoffman Auto Racing Jr. right here. This is for my grandkids. We went and raced indoors with my grandson this past year. He did really, really well, but now my...
In that.
My twin...
Micro?
It's a quarter midget.
Because I was saying micro sprint? No, wait a minute.
Yeah, no,
quarter midget. Smaller, even smaller.
It's okay. Even smaller, yep. It's tiny. But now my twin 6.5-year-old granddaughters want a shot at it, so we'll see how that goes.
Oh, is that old enough, or they need to be a little bit older than that?
They can start practice at 4.5.
Wow.
They're getting a little too old now.
Man, I was learning to ride a bike. Or maybe I wasn't even old enough. I'm not so sure.
So this is a 1929 Buick.
Wow.
Again, I was with my grandfather when he bought this. He came out of a farmer's field, and the farmer had neglected it through the years. We got it back here, and he wanted to do a restore on it. What's interesting about this car is underneath the sheet metal, it's a wood cab.
Wow.
It's made out of hardwood. Well, unfortunately, the termites had gotten to it, so we had to replace all the hardwood underneath the sheet metal and reskin it.
Mm-hmm.
And it's in here because it has holes in its gas tank, and we're replacing the gas tank on it. This shop used to be where we ran the Silver Crown car out of.
Ah.
But since we haven't run the Silver Crown car in 12 years, 15 years, I finally decided to gather all the bits and parts and pieces that were left over from our Indy cars into one area. So all this stuff that you see on the wall belongs to Indy cars. Those are all Offenhauser parts, Offy blocks down here, cranks. There's a complete Cosworth engine sitting over there. It only has dyno time on it. There's another complete Cosworth engine there, except for the block. It's got a broken main well. But yeah, we've got the parts. I've been trying to sell those off to help fund Hoffman Auto Racing, because there's two reasons. I'm never going to use them. And number two, I'd rather see them get back out there and put another car back into existence that's getting restored. I really think that the younger generation needs to see the history of our sport, and that's a part of it. Rear wings, body panels, we've got it all here.
Have you ever traded with the guys over in Brownsburg that are restoring Indy cars, many from 70s and 80s?
They've come down here and looked. They've gotten some stuff from me, but...
So they know of you and they know what you've got.
I'd like for them to come down and buy everything. This is the car that caused my dad to fall in love with racing.
Wow.
It's a 1948 Curtis Craft Midget that my grandfather owned in the 50s. had a bunch of great drivers in the seat, Eddie Sachs and Troy Ruttman, Mike Nazareth. I mean, great names. Unfortunately, we've been doing so much body work in here, it's covered in dust now, so I have to clean it all up again and make it look pretty. I actually got to drive this car around Winchester Speedway at an old timers event. Man, those guys are brave. There's no brake inside the cockpit. It's a handbrake. And so you're braking with your left hand getting in the corner, and then there's an air pump over there on that side, and you got to pump air into it right here. That pumps air into the fuel tank and pushes the gasoline up to the carburetors. So you're basically driving Winchester one-handed, and back in the day, they were running close to 100 mile an hour average on these tiny tires, no roll cage, no seat belts.
Wow. And a leather helmet.
Oh, yeah. Here's a picture of Eddie Sachs driving this car. They won the night before the 500 at the 16th Street Speedway just across the street from the Indianapolis Motor Speedway.
Somewhere around early to mid-50s? Or
yep, early to mid-50s. Yeah, but that was this exact car right here.
In this car we're looking at.
Car we're looking at.
Former night before the 500 winner.
My grandfather tracked it down and bought it and brought it back here, and we did the restoration on it. And it's got a nice 110 cubic inch on it, Offie engine in it. There's nothing like the sound of an Offie. The Buckeye Auto Race Fan Club now has their meetings out here, and they use
this. Oh, they do.
But this has got a lot of memorabilia in it.
Oh, there's a Buckeye Auto Race Fan Club, just like there's a Hoosier Auto Racing Fan Club.
Yeah, this is called BARC, Buckeye Auto Race Fan Club.
And this is the headquarters.
Yeah, well, this is where they meet. So, as you can see, we've got a lot of trophies through the years over here.
Lots of history.
This is an Indy car. That was 1984 at the Indianapolis Motor Speedway. And I was chief mechanic on that car.
Where are you in that phone?
Second from the right.
One, two.
Yep, that's me. My dad, me, my brother. This would be my uncle that's married to one of my twin aunts that is his sister. My grandfather, this is the other uncle that's married to the other twin. And I can't find my Uncle Tom, who is my dad's brother, in that picture. I don't know why. Huh. Absent that day.
Uh-huh.
But yeah, we managed to get that car. It was the only car that was a year old in the race. Everything else was brand new.
86?
84.
84.
Yep. But yeah, it's... Indiana Andy Hillenberg. That's probably the first year or second year that we were racing sprint cars in what I call the modern era. We were not doing any racing in 86. My dad and I would go down to Lawrenceburg Speedway, our local track, and just kind of enjoy watching racing and everything, but we still had the racing bug. And he said, I'll tell you what, you fix up the dual wheel crew cab while I'm on vacation and we'll go get a sprint car. So I did my end of the bargain. We went out and got a Gambler chassis and bought a Gertie motor and went racing. He said, we're just going to have fun with this. We are not going to have any spares. If something breaks, we'll load it in the trailer and we're done. We'll drink beer. It'll be fun. Well, we won the third race. We had mechanical failures the first two races. We won the third race. And our driver said, you know, they run Millstream Speedway on Sunday nights. So we went up there the next night and won there. He goes, you know, they run Bloomington on Friday nights. Before the season was out, we were doing all-star racing. We were racing three nights a week and we're buying all these spares. It just snowballed like you wouldn't believe. Uh-huh. And then we ran for the USAC Championship in 89 and got that. So that's kind of what I call the modern era, the beginning of the modern era of Hoffman Auto Racing.
Uh-huh.
Couple of other cool things here. My grandfather owned 98 Junior at one point in time. Obviously after Agajanian. had it out there. But this is a guy named Mud Anderson, who was a very well-respected mechanic at that time. My grandfather, and here's my father over here in the corner, learning all he can. This guy right here, I don't know whether you're old enough to know this name, but this is Tim Richmond, NASCAR driver. That was his first IndyCar start. Michigan International Speedway for the Michigan 500. We were really idiots back then. We had accumulated three chassis and enough engines to put three cars together, and we had three cars at the Michigan 500. We also took three cars out to California and did the California 500. So, like I said, not very smart, but Tim Richmond got his first IndyCar ride with us. Let's see what else have we got here. Times I'd like to forget. We're leading on a white flag lap and got drilled going into one. Went out of the park. This was in I-70 Speedway, Missouri. And it was part of a USAC deal. We were heading out to Phoenix International to race out there. And the guys were going to have like a week of downtime to go out and explore the West, go to the Grand Canyon, all that stuff. No, instead they had to turn around from the middle of Missouri, come back here so I could rebuild the car, rebuild the chassis, and send them on their way with hardly any time to get there. But we ended up winning the race, so it was all good when it was all said and done. This was our only brand new Indy car that we ever owned. It was a PC7 that we bought new from Roger Penske. So we get to Indianapolis, and this was in the CART USAC era, and CART had different boost rules than USAC, and the engine we had was built for the CART boost rules, not the USAC boost rules, and we were
81
horsepower. 1980. We were down on horsepower, so it was tough. We finally got an engine, leased an engine from McLaren, and got it in there, and then we found out we had the wrong rear wing, so we had to split time with another team on a wing that Roger Penske said, you guys need to share that. Try setting up a car while you're sharing a rear wing. So as soon as we got the car bolted together, we took it out onto the qualifying line and put it in line, and we had three golf carts full of parts following us down the line as we're putting the parts on the car. They get it on all done, and I think we were fourth in line and time ran out. So, had to sell the car. Did not have enough money to keep the car, and that was the end of that one. But, oh God, that was a beautiful car and a great, great car.
And that's the car.
That's the car. That picture does not do it justice. Down here we've got, this is a photo sequence of a crash. Larry Cannon took it at Winchester in 1971. And this was before arm restraints, and the car had a bolt-on roll cage. But the roll cage held up. However, like in this photo here, his arms are on the ground, his head is on the ground.
Yikes.
And he had a concussion and a bruised shoulder, but other than that, he was fine.
No broken bones.
No broken bones is what the car looked like. It was basically sheared off to the front of the motor. And we raced that car the next weekend.
Amazing.
It had a few handprints in the frame where we painted it and didn't have enough time to let it dry, but yeah, we raced it at New Bremen the next weekend. And of course, we've got a bunch of trophies that we got through the years. I've got to tell you that probably some of the most impressive trophies were back there at the Western World. This is a second place trophy. I can't imagine.
Four and a half feet tall.
Hmm?
Like 4.5 feet tall.
Yeah.
For second place.
The Western World was probably the scene of one of our, I'll say the greatest win that I've had, or one of the greatest wins that I've had. We were late to staging. And by late to staging, I mean you had to be on the front straightaway at a certain time. USAC decreed that. And if you weren't there, then you got penalized. And we were 30 seconds late, if that. But we were late. And their penalty was to take us from the front row starting spot that we had earned to the tail. And Jerry Coons Jr. was the driver. And I just wanted to pull the car out and tell him to go, you know what. But Coons said, no, let me try. Let me see what I can get. He drove that thing to the wind in 40 lap race, yeah. But I mean, he was just absolutely on fire. He was just out there, started 24th and was passing a car almost every lap out there.
Wow.
It was absolutely hooked up and wired.
Eldora, Phoenix, Richmond, all over.
Yeah, the only track that I never won at that I really wanted to win at was Knoxville. I really wanted to win there. But, you know, all the time that I was crew chiefing, we only ran there once.
Banner that says USAC National Sprint Champions, Brady Bacon, and that's 2016.
That was 2016. That was the year that I retired after that season.
And then next to it, Richard Hoffman, your dad.
Yep. They did that as a memorial when he passed away in 2019. USAC did that, and everybody had decals on their cars with that, so it was really nice. So, this is the first sprint car that I ever built. And it is a Buick V6 pavement car. It was built specifically for Rich Vogler. The funny thing is that this one, and this one, we were all there, little 500.
Wow.
And Kurt.
And this is what year?
This is 1989. And Kurt.
More than 30 years later.
Yeah, 30 years later. Kurt Stemmer is a pharmacist in Florida, and he came up here just to do the little 500 with me.
Oh, so he knows about the whole Florida connection that happened this weekend about Jack Nowling Award. And
Well, he was born and raised up here,
uh-huh.
And they moved down there. He and I went to college together. He moved down there, I guess, in the mid-2000s and has been down in Panama City ever since, and he's in the same city that my son is stationed in the Air Force in down there. So obviously whenever I'm going down to see him, I'm seeing Kurt and his wife Sherry as well. But yeah, this Buick V6, it was purpose-built, and I had no idea what I was doing, but somehow the gods smiled on me and I did everything right. This car, I believe it raced 13 times and set 11 new track records and had 3 wins. The biggest problem that we had was the Buick V6 engine. Nobody made a brass gear for the distributor, the magneto in it. And the V6 vibrates so badly, and with the direct drive and no dampener, the gears, the steel gears would shatter. So we had, I think, 2 or 3 DNFs because of the gears on it. And I built this car. I had to build the car wide because the Buick V6 is a wide engine. It wouldn't fit through the frame rails of a narrow car. Car didn't win a race until we put it back on center. And from there, it was just pretty much unstoppable. Rich and this car were just absolutely made for one another.
And that was what year?
1989.
89.
Seems like another lifetime ago.
That's a while back.
Yeah. Then I told you that we had this 1912 Mets here.
Wow.
It's a pretty damn cool car on its own. But this car was renowned for its hill climbing ability. Now my grandfather, who obviously was born in 1911, so he knew a little something about the cars back in that day. He told me that this was called the mother-in-law seat, or also when the man came out to take his girlfriend out on a date, the chaperone would sit back here, conveniently right behind the fuel tank, and then this was the trunk. And what's really cool about this car is it has a drive shaft on it that comes back and drives this great big plate drive flywheel. And then the handle on the side there, that's the gear shift, and that actuates this cross shaft and the wheel on that, and it just, as you pull it back, it moves it further out, which gives you a higher gear. And then you go over center and you have reverse. Goes better than that. They have chains then driving off that jack shaft back to the rear axle, and they've got a differential on the jack shaft so the thing can go around the corners better. This is 1912. I mean, I'm astounded at how far we've come, but also the things that are still the same. Or, I mean, this is basically a continuously variable transmission, if you will. Same concept, obviously a lot different in the application nowadays, but same concept, they had it in 1912. All these buildings were filled with cars, literally filled with cars when my grandfather died. I keep saying one of these days when I'm done with racing, but I don't know when that will ever be.
As far as what year will that be, you can't say.
Well, I really want to, my grandfather started the team in 1929, and I really want to get to 100 years, so 2029.
Wow.
I'll be 65 then, 66.
And that'll be the 100th year of 100th.
Well, Hoffman Racing Team. Yeah, the 100th year of racing would be 2028, but after 2028, we'll have been doing it for 100 years, so yeah.
Wow, amazing.
Yeah. My grandfather, how all this insanity started, he and two buddies wanted to race cars. So they found a car that was abandoned, and it was a, I want to say Model T Speedster. It had like a bobtail on the back. And they took it out of the ditch where it was abandoned and took it to one of the kids' garages. His dad owned a garage. And there are three of them there were named my grandfather, Gus. And then he loved to give nicknames to people, so I can't even tell you their real names. But it was Greasy Johnson, who owned, his father owned the garage, and Cockeyed Collier. And yeah, unfortunately, apparently as a child, he was hit in the head with a brick and one of his eyes went off to the side. So these three decide they're going to get a race car and they're going to race it. And Greasy Johnson said, you know, Model T's got a splash system for oiling the bearings, and, you know, that won't hold up the rigors of racing. We're going to have to put a pressurized oiling system on there. So they took turns for 2 days running, you know what a breast bit is?
Mm-hmm.
A breast bit drill through the crankshaft of this Model T engine in order to pressure feed it. And old Greasy looked at it after it was all done. He said, his holes aren't that straight, but I reckon the oil won't know any difference anyway. And they put it together and he went out racing. Now they all wanted to drive, so they drew straws and they were gonna take turns. My grandfather took his turn driving. And he said he got out there, and these guys are running all over the place, you know, chopping him off, and rocks are flying up and hitting him. And he said, hell with that. Never drove again. And he didn't want any of us to drive.
Uh-huh.
Of course, my dad pretty much stuck to that. I think he drove once
or
twice.
Not letting his sons drive.
No. He didn't drive. He drove like once or twice. I drove a little bit more, but not a whole lot more than that.
Yeah.
And I actually got to drive the 69 a couple of times when they had short fields or there was some other issue.
And your father didn't try to stop it from happening?
Oh, they like to stop it. Yeah, but you know, I was the only person they had available. USAC might have a short car count at a pavement race, and we had two cars. So, you know, Steve Butler was driving the primary and I was in the backup, and I'd just go out and qualify and run a heat race and take one lap in the feature and be done.
That kind
of thing. But there was one time that Butler didn't like the car, the primary car, so he wanted to drive the Buick V6 in the heat race and feature. And so we swapped cars. And I had to drive the supposed primary car, but because it had already qualified, that's what the points were on for our championships. So my dad said, you're gonna have to run the whole race, Rob. And I did, and it was the most evil handling piece of crap I've ever been in my life. Same problem that I had with my cars, the driveline, same problem on that car. That's why I knew that I had a driveline issue with my Beast and the other two cars now. Mm. And thankfully I got it fixed on the Beast eventually in time for qualifying. But the number of laps that I ran is minuscule. I did have a lot of fun when I was behind the wheel though. I wish that I would have been able to do it more. To the Chief Mechanic in the USAC Sprint Car Division, a Jack Nowling Award presented for outstanding achievement, a car owner and builder at the Little 500, and then the Lawrenceburg Speedway Feature Winner Trophy, which was from 1987. That was my first win as a Chief Mechanic in the Sprint Car Series, and kind of a special thing to me. It's the first win of what I call the modern era of sprint car racing for Hoffman Auto Racing.